I want to welcome everybody, especially you, joining with us today at all of our locations. Big shout out to everybody that is at Boca Pop-Up. We're going to be joining with you this Sunday, 6 p.m. Down at Olympic Heights High School. We love you guys so much. So excited about what God is doing as we jump into twice a month down at Boca and twice a month up in Vero. Things are stirring up in our pop-up world. We got more for that later. But we want to take a moment today to pray. And we want to pray for our neighbors down in the Bahamas.
Yeah.
As much as we are grateful that the storm did not come to our communities, our hearts are devastated and broken for what we're seeing, both firsthand by our teams that are down there and what we're seeing on the TV. And so we just want to pray for them, pray for our neighbors, but we want to say thank you.
Yeah, church, thank you so much. You guys are the most generous people that we know. And over these last couple of days, we've been able to bless the people of the Bahamas by getting supplies down to them. We've been working these last couple of days to get supplies down. Even yesterday, we actually sent 6 planes down there with medical supplies, food, water, and every one of you have been a part of that.
And not only getting the supplies down, but because of our partnership with Convoy of Hope, we have team on the ground in the Bahamas, in Freeport, making sure that the supplies we're sending down are getting to the people that need it most.
Yeah, we've actually started putting together care packages for those people from the Bahamas that are starting to arrive here in our own communities, and we'll let you know how to be a part of that in the days to come, but we're ready for them when they get here to be able to share what they need and also just some of the love and hope of Jesus.
And what's amazing is through our partnership with Church United, which is what we lead all the churches in our region down in Broward here and then up in the Treasure Coast, we as a church are working together to fund the Field Hospital of Samaritan's Purse right in Grand Bahamas right there. So that hospital is set up right there in Grand Bahama to take care of those that are hurting and broken, and we get to be a part of helping to fund that and make that happen. So that's, we just want to say thank you for your partnership and helping us love these people in their time of need, all right? So let's pray. Let's pray for our neighbors down in the Bahamas, for God's strength and peace for them. And then I want to pray for the Word of God as Julie begins to open our hearts to what God wants to say over our church this weekend. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are the God that neither slumbers nor sleeps. And right now we pray for your hand of peace and comfort to be with all our brothers and sisters down in the Bahamas. God, we pray that you would let them know that you are near and that you are close. Would you, God, restore what has been broken. God, would you calm their nerves and their fears, God, and just speak peace over them, I pray. And continue to let the church be the church and be the hands and feet of Jesus to these precious people, we pray. Lord, we pray for this word as it's opened up. Would you teach us today? Would you help us to understand everything that you want us to grab in our hearts in this moment we're in? In Jesus' name we pray. Together, everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. Now, usually you kiss me and leave,
I know,
but now I get
to kiss me. That's so good. You know, these last few weeks, Todd has been talking a lot about moments, right? And that there are some moments that actually stand out above the rest. There's moments that leave an imprint on us. And sometimes I think it's really good for me to get up here and share maybe a little bit of my side of the story. Because he actually has been sharing some pretty special moments. He shared with you about our first kiss. And I don't have time to tell you my side of the story, but I will tell you that there was no death grip and I did not assault him. That's all I'm gonna say and leave it at that. But another moment that he shared about was that moment when things got fuzzy around the edges. And if you were here a couple weeks ago, he shared about the time that after 18 months of being apart and broken up, after 18 months of just being friends, one night, Todd decided to take me out to dinner, and at the end of that night, he got down on one knee, and he asked me to marry him. It was amazing, and he talked about getting fuzzy around the edges, but I just want to give you a little bit of the backstory of that. There was actually a moment before the moment. See, it was a Saturday night, and I was actually working at a local department store here in Palm Beach Gardens, and Todd and I had been hanging out a lot, which meant that we actually would just go out with a bunch of people and have pizza. Well, on this particular night, he was getting ready to go back to college, so he asked if I would go out to dinner. And I said yes, but as the night went on, I was starting to get a little bit tired. And actually, I started thinking, I really should probably play a little bit hard to get. And so I actually thought about canceling the date that night. But then I decided I wanted to see my friend one more time before he left for college. And at the end of the night, like I said, you know, he got down on one knee and asked me to marry him. And for him, things were fuzzy around the edges. But my first response was, no way. Are you kidding me? I mean, this is not anything of what I expected from that night. And I started thinking about that moment. You know, I thought about canceling because my expectation that night was really for dominoes. It was not for a diamond. And when he surprised me, you know, and asked me to marry him, I didn't see it coming. And I started thinking that in that moment that he asked me to marry him, everything changed. My name changed, my future changed, and every chapter of my story from that moment on was written with Todd's name in it. See, this moment changed everything. And you've heard us say before that not all time is created equal. That moment kind of stands out above the rest. And see, in scripture, there's actually a different definition of time. Time is defined two ways. In the English language, we have one definition for time. In the Greek language, which is what the New Testament was written in originally, there's actually two words for the word time. There's chronos time, which we get the word chronological. It's minutes and hours and days and weeks, and that really measures the quantity of time. But there's another word that actually describes how God measures time, and that word is kairos. And kairos isn't about a quantity of a moment, but it's actually about the quality of that moment. This is the definition of kairos. It says it's a season of time and opportunity when conditions are right for something crucial to be accomplished. It's an appointed time for decision. And see, I did not know that night when I showed up for work and I was standing at that checkout counter that at the end of that night, there was a kairos moment waiting for me. I didn't know that there was a new season waiting for me, and I could have missed it, all because of some lame excuse of not being up to it, or maybe because my expectations were too low, or I could have left my answer at no way. See, I had to say yes to the offer that was made before I could actually step in to the kairos moment. See, what I want you to know is that you may not know it right now, and you may have come in here like it was any other weekend service at Christ Fellowship. But I really believe that God has a kairos moment, a new season for you in the days and the weeks ahead. See, in these coming weeks, we have set aside this coming season and these next 3 months as a kairos season, a season of time and opportunity. And we are praying that in these coming weeks that God is going to do an amazing work in your life, that you would experience him in such a tangible, powerful way, and that there would be nothing that could keep you back from the destiny and the purpose that he has for you. But I want you to know that the stepping into a kairos moment is gonna take all of us stepping up together, and it's gonna take putting aside our lame excuses, right? Raising our expectations and saying yes to all that God has waiting for us in this season. See, God has put this word on my heart as we step into this new season. And I wanna share the word that God has put on my heart because I am praying that you are ready to receive the word that he has for you today. See, I'm going to be reading from the book of Numbers, and Numbers is a book in the Old Testament. It's not a very popular book, probably because of its name, Numbers. I am not very good at math, so I usually stay away from this book. I steered away, but in the Hebrew, that word, the book is called Bamidbar, which means in the wilderness. See, it's the Israelites' adventure journey through the wilderness to get to the promised land. And just a little bit of a background about this story that we're gonna jump into today. See, at the beginning of the book of Numbers, Moses has just led the children of Israel out of Egypt, where they had been held in captivity and slavery for hundreds of years. God crossed the Red Sea for them, and God defeated the Egyptian army, and there they were on the other side of the sea, and they ended up at Mount Sinai. See, when they got to Mount Sinai, it was there that God gave them the Ten Commandments, and he taught them how to care for his presence as they made their journey into the Promised Land. Because they'd been in captivity and slavery for so long, they had no idea how to govern themselves as a free people. So God gave them guidelines, and he gave them the Ten Commandments to begin to do this. And so they began what should have been a really short journey to the Promised Land. And just a few weeks into the journey, Moses sent some spies into the Promised Land to check it out. Two of the spies, Joshua and Caleb, they came back to Moses and they said, "Moses, we've got this. I mean, this is a land flowing with milk and honey. It is exactly what God said, and we are with you. We are ready to go in and take the land." But then 10 other spies came back, and they came back and they were scared to death. They said that they're people. They look like giants. And compared to them, we look like grasshoppers. And so they begin to spread lies around the camp of the children of Israel. And so pretty soon, there was a revolt and a rebellion against Moses. They even actually tried to kill Moses. So they decided that the 10 of them and most of the children of Israel decided they did not want to go into the Promised Land. And God honored their choice not to go into the Promised Land. By the way, God will honor our choice not to do what he says, and we will miss out on the Promised Land that he has for us. But see, what happened from here is that they began to wander for 40 years in the wilderness, and he honored that generation, after that generation had all passed away, those that had rebelled and revolted had all passed away, and now 40 years later, a new generation has stepped up. And see, God was like, if that generation isn't gonna work with me, then I'm gonna wait for the next one that will. And this is where we pick up the story. See, Moses and the Israelites are in Moab, and they're right across the Jordan River, the Promised Land, and there's a new generation that's positioned and ready to take the land. And so the Lord tells Moses to take the census of everyone, which they do in Numbers chapter 26. It reads like a team roster for Team Israel. In Numbers 26, it says that these were the clans descended from the sons of Reuben: the Hanukkite clan, named after their ancestor Hanok; the Paluite clan, named after their ancestor Palu; the Hexronite clan and the Termite clan and the Carmite clan. There were the clans of Reuben, and their numbers registered 43,730. And on it goes for 45 more verses. You can understand why people don't really dig in to the book of Numbers. But what I want you to know is there is a treasure hidden in this book. See, God then tells Moses to distribute the land according to the size of the tribes of Israel. The bigger the tribe, the more land that they would receive. See, this count was important. Every tribe, every clan, every man was counted. See, there were two reasons they needed to count the men. One was so that they knew how many men that they had that were ready for battle. But the other reason was, is so they would know how to divide the land according to each tribe, so each member was insured their inheritance. See, it wasn't just about the land. It was about the fulfillment of God's promise. And I can't even imagine the anticipation that was building in the camp. God was getting ready to do something new. The day that they had dreamed of was finally arrived, and the 40 years of wandering were over. See, this new generation was getting ready to step in to the Promised Land and get ready to take hold of the inheritance God had for them. And I'm so excited about this next passage of scripture, because until a year ago, I had never heard a sermon preached on this scripture. I had never heard a song sung about this scripture. And I'm not even gonna ask for a show of hands to ask you how many people know about the five daughters of Zelophehad. And if you're out there and you were dying to raise your hand, you were probably homeschooled. That's all I'm saying. Or you were at Sisterhood Nights last year, because I did preach from this passage last year at Sisterhood Nights. But I'm telling you, there is so much that I didn't even get to in that one night, and I'm so excited about the revelation that God has given me in his word about the five daughters of Zelophehad for this season of our church. So I want to jump in, because I really believe that the five daughters of Zelophehad could have very easily been the five most powerful women in the Bible because they had the courage to do something that had never been done before. And Numbers 27, it picks up and it says this, starting in verse 1, the daughters of Zelophehad, son of Hepher, son of Gilead, the son of Machir, the son of Manasseh, belonged to the clans of Manasseh, son of Joseph. The names of the daughters were Mahlah, Noah, Kogla, Milcah, and Tirzah. They came forward and stood before Moses, Eleazar the priest, and the leaders of the whole assembly at the entrance of the tent meeting and said, our father died in the wilderness. He was not among Korah's followers who banded together against the Lord, which means he wasn't part of the rebellion that stood up against Moses, but he died for his own sin like the rest of the generation did, and he left no sons. Why should our father's name disappear from his clan because he had no son? Give us property among our father's relatives. So Moses brought their case before the Lord. And I want to stop here because it's really easy to get stuck here at the obvious injustice that is happening here, an injustice that is happening to women. And we see that all over the world and all throughout history that women have been oppressed. And what I want you to know is that even around the globe today, even though we see injustice to women, that God loves all people equally. And Jesus spent so much of his ministry bringing honor and value to women who lived in a culture that oppressed them. And I don't want to give a spoiler alert here, but what you're going to see in this story is that this is one of the many stories throughout Scripture that even when culture and society gets it wrong, God always gets it right. He always gets it right. See, these girls, they had a huge problem. They were single women in a culture where they had no rights to property, and they had no brothers and no father to claim the inheritance that everybody else was going to get. In the entire census, 601,750 people counted, they didn't count. And by law, they didn't matter. See, whatever the promised land was going to look like for everyone else, it wouldn't include them. But here they were on the edge of the most exciting story, the chapter of the story that was getting ready to be written in the children of Israel, and they were getting ready to miss out on it. See, God was getting ready to do something new, and these girls didn't want to miss out on it. So they did something that had never been done before. They didn't stay stuck in their circumstances. They didn't start a rebellion and rally support. They stood up together and they took their case to the one that could do something about it. They brought their case to their mediator, who was Moses, who would then bring their case to God. They raised their hands and they said, hey, count us in. Count us in. Even though it hasn't been like this for 2,000 years, this law doesn't seem to line up with the character of the God that we came to love and we came to know in the wilderness. And even though we have never seen the promised land and we don't even know exactly what we're asking for, we believe that God has an inheritance for us even if we can't see it. The title of my message today is, Hey God, Count me in. Count me in. See, God is always writing new stories. He's always writing new chapters in our stories. He wants to take us out of our wilderness and bring us into new seasons of destiny and purpose so we can experience the strength and the power that he came to give us. And see, what I love about the five daughters of Zelophehad is that while they were still in the wilderness, they were believing for an inheritance that they had never seen before. And I just have to wonder if we would be so courageous, that today, if we would raise our hands and say, God, count me in. See, God, I want to believe you for an inheritance, even though I have never seen it before. I may have been living in this wilderness of depression and anxiety for far too long, but I am believing, God, today that you have a new season of joy for me to step into in my future. I have only seen divorce and brokenness in my family for generations, but God, I am believing that you want to write a new story on my family. God, I had this dream that's died inside of me because I didn't think I was strong enough or good enough or just enough. But God, today, I want you to count me in because I don't want to miss one part of the inheritance that you have for me. See, what I want you to know is that when you say, God, count me in, you are actually taking the first step into the divine inheritance that God has for you. Let me say that again. When you say, God, count me in, you're actually taking the first step into this divine inheritance that God has for you. And the first step of faith is always the hardest. And it always takes the most courage. If you look at the story, it says that these five sisters came before Moses, Eleazar the priest, the leaders, and the whole assembly at the entrance of the tent of meeting. They had to stand at the entrance. They weren't even allowed to walk into the tent of meeting. How intimidating must this have been? See, they disrupted the status quo because you know that with over a million people in the camp, they could not have been the first orphaned girls. They were not the first orphaned girls, but there were surely other orphaned girls, but they were the first to step up and to stand up to the leaders in the community. There was no precedent for this. And I can't even imagine the stares of disbelief that had to be in the court that day. People that looked at them and thought, who do they think they are to question us? Who do they think they are to question God? You know, there were so many in that court that day that were probably counting them out. But when others counted the daughters of Zelophehad out, they stepped up. They stepped up. They moved out from the life that was handed to them and into the inheritance that God had for them. See, they actually stepped out of their history and into their destiny. And some of you, I know, life has handed you some really tough stuff. And you may feel like others are counting you out. And maybe you've started counting yourself out. But what I want you to know is that even when others count you out, God always counts you in. See, in verse 5, it says that Moses brought their case before the Lord. The Lord said to them, what Zelophehad's daughters are saying is right. You must certainly give them property as an inheritance. It was his answer was instantaneous. There was no hesitation. It was as if he was just waiting for somebody to ask. And see, he doesn't stop there. He goes on to say say to the Israelites, if a man dies and leaves no son, give his inheritance to his daughter. This is to have the force of law for the Israelites as the Lord commanded Moses. And what I love about this is that God gave them more than what they asked for. He gave them their inheritance, but he also wrote it into law for future generations so no daughter, no sister would ever have to wonder if they would ever be able to have access to the inheritance that God had for them. See, they didn't know it, but there were girls in future generations that were actually counting on them. They were actually counting them. See, without the inheritance, the daughters of Zelophehad were destined for a life of poverty, which meant that all the generations after them, every girl, every sister, every daughter was destined for a life of poverty. But what I want you to hear is that their pain became a part of their purpose. Their pain became somebody else's passport into the promised land. But what I want you to hear is this. Before their pain could have a purpose, this pain and poverty had to become a part of their past. They had to leave their past of pain and poverty and step into the inheritance that God had for them. See, they had to step into and lay claim to the inheritance God had. And what I want you to hear is that some of you have been carrying around the pain of your past for so long. And I want you to know that you have a good, good father that's just waiting for you to ask. He's waiting for you to ask for the inheritance that is rightfully yours. Galatians says that so we would know that for sure we are his true children. God released the spirit of sonship into your hearts. moving us to cry out, "My Father, you are our true Father. Now we are no longer living like slaves, but we can enjoy being God's very own sons and daughters. And because of this, we can have access to everything our Father has. For we are heirs of God through Jesus the Messiah." See, as his child, you are an heir. And as an heir, you have an inheritance. And that inheritance that God has for you is freedom. See, you don't have to beg for it. You don't have to earn it. But you do have to step up and you have to claim it. Not because of what you've done, but because of who you are. And for some of you, God is speaking to you today that it's time to step out of the life that was handed to you and step into the inheritance that God has for you. You may have made a mistake, but I want you to know you are not a mistake. God has an inheritance of forgiveness from the shame and the mistakes of your past. You no longer have to be bound up with shame. You may feel that you've been forgotten, but God has not forgotten you. You may feel that your innocence was robbed as a child, but that doesn't mean that you are not a loved child of a good, good father. And what I want you to know that he has an inheritance for you that is freedom from the pain of your past. He wants to do a deep work in you so that he can do a great work through you. I want you to know that some of you, there might be someone in your past that didn't want you, but that does not mean that you are unwanted. I want you to know that God says that you are a masterpiece. You are accepted. You are a chosen child of a loved, good father. See, you have an inheritance of sonship and daughtership, and you have an inheritance of God's family. And what I want you to know about this family, God's family, is that we are fighting for your freedom. We are fighting for your freedom. See, last January, we stepped into the new year. We declared a word over this house that God had burnt on our hearts. And that word was freedom. And what I want you to know is that word freedom was not a sermon series and it wasn't a slogan. It was actually a holy declaration because we knew that we were no longer gonna stand aside and watch the next generation be taken out and gripped by fear and anxiety when we know that we serve a God that wants to pour out his spirit on the younger generation so they can be a beacon of light and hope. It was a declaration over you and your families because we know that for so long, so many of you have been living with the pain of your past and you're thinking that this is as good as it gets. But we want you to know that God has more. And we knew that this declaration of freedom was really a battle cry. It was a battle cry because we're sick and tired of seeing God's people live in spiritual poverty when we know that he came to give you an extravagant inheritance, an inheritance of uncontainable joy, unexplainable peace, unlimited potential. And we are here to fight for that. And so this, we are declaring that this is a season of freedom. See, we've cleared the decks in these coming weeks. This is gonna be a season like no other. Even over the last few months, we've been getting all of our leaders prepared. I think about Laura. And Laura went through our freedom study. And she had been living with a deep pain from her past. Because 2 years ago, her son had committed suicide. And when that happened, it was as if her heart broke. She said she could actually feel a physical crack in her heart. And she went through the freedom study and then went to the freedom encounter. And through that experience, she said that there was a moment where God came in and she sensed the power of the Holy Spirit in such a powerful way that she could feel the crack closed up. And she could feel that the pain was part of her past, that this wasn't as good as it was gonna get, that God had a future that she was going to get to step into. There's so many stories that we're hearing. Stuart, that God had showed him that there were lies he was believing that were keeping him from all that he had for him. I think about Olivia, who's on our team, and she volunteers as a worship leader and how God has given her freedom over anxiety and depression. And there's story after story. See, we've cleared the decks, and many of these leaders have already been through the Freedom Study already, because they know that free people. And so they're ready to and positioned to walk so many of you through the same experiences that they've had. See, we really believe that this next season is a Kairos season. Let me show you the definition again. It's a season of time and opportunity when conditions are right, for something crucial to be accomplished. The conditions are right. We are opening up our doors at all of our locations like never before, so that everyone that calls Christ Fellowship their home can experience the freedom that God has for them. But it also says it's an appointed time of decision. See, we don't want you to miss your moment, but it's going to be your choice. It's your decision. Will you make this moment count? Will you raise your hand and say, God, count me in? See, when I was preparing this message, there was this one question that kept haunting me. See, if God is all-powerful and all-knowing and all-just, why didn't he just get it right the first time? Why didn't he make the law with that contingency in there for the five daughters of Zelophehad? It would have saved them a lot of trouble and a lot of heartache, and it would have saved the court a lot of time that day. Why didn't he just get it right the first time? And I started thinking about this, that he could have written the law with all the contingencies inside of it that would have made all the accommodations. But if everything had been spelled out, then they would never have asked. And see, I really believe that we have a God that doesn't just want to set things in order and then walk away. See, we have a personal, present God who stands ready to answer our prayers. See, when they asked, God knew that it was the right time. See, this ask, so that at just the right time, I believe that he could reveal a certain aspect of his character that they would have never experienced any other way. See, God wanted them to ask specifically and personally for something so that he could show them a part of himself that they had never experienced before. See, when the daughters of Zelophehad asked for their inheritance, it went on record, and then it was written into law that God was not only a God who could build up a nation, but that he is a personal, accessible God who wants to build into our lives. See, if they had never asked, they would have never known the inheritance that God had for them. And so when you think about it, as they were standing on the edge of the promised land, before they actually went into the tent of meeting, the only thing that was standing between them and their inheritance was a big, bold ask. The ask, the request that they made known to God. I believe that if we're going to access all that God has for us in these days that we're stepping into, that we have to ask for it. God's word has a lot to say about what we can ask God for in our prayers. Matthew 7 says, ask and it will be given to you. John 14, whatever you ask in prayer, you will receive. Philippians 4, let your requests be known to God. James 4 says, you have not because you ask not. See, we have a good, good Father that just wants you to ask. He wants you to ask. And if we want to have access to the inheritance that God has for us, I really believe that we have to do what the daughters of Zelophehad did. We have to ask specifically. Specifically. They came and they said, we want the land that everybody else is getting. And today I want you to know that God wants to do something specific for you, but you have to ask for it. Maybe it's you want to be free from anxiety, from anger, from depression. Maybe what specifically you want God to do is something, you want God to do something new with an old problem. You've been circling this problem for so long, you thought you had it wrestled to the ground, and it just pops up again and again. I want you to know that God wants to do something new with your old problem. Maybe you want him to heal you from the pain of your past, or to let go of some bitterness that's been hanging on. Maybe so you just want to be able to step into the new season God has for you. I don't know what specifically you want God to do for you, but I want you to just take a minute to just write that down. What is it that you want God to do for you? And you might be sitting there thinking, I don't know, but I know there has to be more. I don't know exactly what to ask for, but I have a sense that there has to be more. That's pretty specific. Ask God to show you the more. Would you just write that down? In a minute, we're gonna pray for those. So I want you to write that down because I want you to take that with you in the coming weeks. Over this next season, I want you to ask every single day. You have a Heavenly Father that hears and answers prayers. And secondly, we have to ask expectantly. See, God wants to do exceedingly abundantly above everything we could hope, dream, or ask. But we have to be prepared for the more that God is going to give us. We have to be prepared that God's going to give you more than what you're asking for. And see, being expectant, it isn't just a feeling. You know, okay, God, I'm ready. Lay it on me. That's not expectation. See, expectation demands preparation. If I'm gonna have someone, if I'm expecting someone to come over to dinner, I have to make sure that I've adjusted some things on my calendar and that I have more in my refrigerator than some leftover Chipotle. I've gotta do some preparation, right? Expectant mothers, you know what I'm talking about. When you are expectant, there's some change that's happening. You're getting your home ready. You're reworking your calendar. You're getting ready for the change that's coming, even if you don't even know exactly what that change is gonna look like. See, what I believe is that we have been preparing a lot around here. We are expectant for you. And what we say a lot around here is that if you wanna see some things you've never seen before, you're gonna have to do some things you've never done before. We've never had an 8-week study totally devoted for you to step into the freedom that God has for you. We've never done freedom encounters before where you can experience the power of the Holy Spirit after you've been through the process of what you're gonna walk through in these 8 weeks. We've never canceled almost everything on the church calendar and opened our doors 6 days a week so that people could experience the freedom that God has for them. I want you to know we're expectant and we're prepared. And I want you to know that you may need to adjust your calendar. You may need to adjust your schedule so that you can be expectant and ready and make room for the work that God wants to do. See, your ask, asking specifically, asking expectantly, is really your first step into this Kairos season. And as we close, I just have one challenge for you, and that is this, that you would make this moment count. And when I say make this moment count, I mean this moment where God is stirring in your heart and actually stirring up your faith that maybe there's more. Maybe I can believe for more than what I've been experiencing. But it's also this moment, this season, that we as a church are stepping into together, that you would make this moment count and that you would be counted in for this moment. And I only have one way that you can do this, because we are asking that everybody that calls Christ Fellowship their home, that every one of you would get yourself and get your big ask to the Freedom Study. Get yourself and get your big ask. Gotta be careful when I say that. Wasn't sure if I was allowed to say that, babe. But we need to get to this Freedom Study, get into the experience where God is going to begin to do a deep work. That's all I've got. Because I really believe that this is a season like no other season. We are gonna see lives change like never before. I am believing that there are gonna be relationships restored. I'm believing that there's going to be such a generational impact that the kids of our house are going to step into freedom like they've never seen before, that schools are gonna be different, that workplaces are gonna be different, that our region is gonna be different because we stepped up together. See, there's power and there's strength in numbers, and we're gonna do this together. So I want to pray for you. Those of you who wrote something down, I just want you to open your hands up like this to receive what God has for you in this moment. Let's pray together. God, I just thank you because we know that when we ask, we know that you are a God who hears, that you are a God who builds nations, and you are a God that is personal and up close enough that wants to build into our lives. I pray, God, for all the requests that you see, the asks that are all around all of our campuses and in the seats today, represented by each person sitting here. I pray, God, that you would begin now to stir up our faith, to be able to step into the freedom, into a new season of freedom like we have never seen before. I pray, God, that you would, that these requests, we want to make them known to you. God, we want to make them known to you because we are believing that you want to pour out your spirit in such a great way in these coming days. God, that these, that 3 months from now, that when we look in the mirror, we won't recognize ourselves. And when we look at our church, we won't recognize this church because of all that you are wanting to do in this Kairos season that we're stepping into together. And with every head bowed and every eye closed, you may be here today and you may not even know if you can have access to all that I've been talking about, this inheritance of joy and of peace. And I just want you to know that if you're here, the only way that you can have access to that is through a relationship with Jesus Christ. And maybe you're here today and you've never had a relationship with Jesus, or maybe you had a relationship at one time, but you know that it's not where it needs to be. But today you're saying, I want to step into a new season. I want to step into all that God has for me. If you have never made that decision before, maybe you've made that before and you want to recommit your life, would you just raise your hand so I can pray for you? Because I really believe that God is wanting you to step into a season in the coming days of knowing him. Yes. Church, we're gonna pray together. I want everyone to pray this prayer, but if your hand is in the air, I want you to pray this a little bit louder because this is your prayer. Dear Jesus, I want to be counted in.
I want to be counted in.
For all that you have for me.
For all that you have for me.
You are a good God.
You are a good God.
And you have good things for me.
And you have good things for me.
Today I declare. I want to be a Christian.
I want to be a Christian.
A follower of Jesus Christ.
A follower of Jesus
Christ. I pray that you will forgive me of my sin.
I pray that you will forgive me of my sin.
And from this day forward, I will live for you.
I will live for you.
All the days of my life.
All the days of my life.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen, church.